Have you ever had one of those times where somebody asked you a question and it just kind of stopped you in your tracks? You didn't really know how to respond. You didn't know what was going on. You didn't know how to react to the question. Well, I had one of those one time. It was a question that probably was one of the most probing questions ever asked of me. It was probably also one of the most convicting questions I'd ever had asked. And one of the most difficult questions I'd ever had asked. And it wasn't when Jerry asked me to marry her. Seriously. There we were living in a community where our lives were pretty stable. We had decent income from good jobs, surrounded by family and friends. But see, I knew beyond a doubt that God had called me to ministry. And so all of these questions were in our hearts and in our minds. How can you just quit your job? How can you just pick up and move your family 6 hours away? How, as a father and as a husband, do you provide for your family? How were we going to eat? Could we even find jobs? Where would we live? All of those questions swirling in our mind, and we at least had sense enough to go and sit and talk to somebody about it, and we were sitting with our pastor at the time and his wife, and we were discussing these things over a meal. There was fear, there was doubt, there were concerns, and all those things at the same time. And then out of the clear blue, the pastor's wife asked me that question. She looked me in the eye and she said, "What do you not trust about God?" You say, "Well, that's not a hard question." Yeah, it was for me at the time. It's not a hard question when there's nothing big in front of you. But for me, see, it brought me face to face with the fact that I either had to trust God or admit that I didn't trust God. It was probably the first time in my life from a spiritual perspective that I had to either put up or shut up. As I looked at the future, I knew there was going to be struggle. I knew there were risks to be taken. But the question was, did I really believe God was my provider, my sustainer, my protector? See, I had come face to face with a moment that I could no longer claim Christ without living for Christ. I could no longer claim that He was the one that I trusted without living like I trusted Him. Well, today as we look at 1 Peter chapter 4, we're going to look at verses 12 through 19. And I believe that we as individual Christians and we as a church need to ask ourselves that question that I was confronted with 24 years ago. What do you not trust about God? What do you not trust about God? Let's pray. Lord God, we thank You that we know Your Holy Spirit is here today. Lord, even as we worshiped this morning, we felt the presence of Your Spirit. God, we sang about Your blood, and so we trust You for our salvation. But Lord, I guess the question is, do we trust You for our everyday life as believers? You tell us in Colossians that we are to walk in the same manner which we were saved, and that is by faith, and that is in trust in You. So Lord, may Your word confront us today with things that are in our lives, things that are ahead of us. And may we determine to be people that not only say we trust You, but live like we trust You. So Lord, speak to us today. Do a work in our hearts today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As Peter writes here, he encourages us in about three areas of how we are to live, how are we to demonstrate that we trust God in our lives? The first thing I see here is that he says we need to endure the tests. Look at verses 12 through 14 of 1 Peter chapter 4. He says, "Dear friends, when the fiery ordeal arises among you to test you, don't be surprised by it, as if something unusual were happening to you. Instead, as you share in the sufferings of the Messiah, rejoice, so that you may also rejoice with great joy at the revelation of his glory. If you are ridiculed for the name of Christ, you are blessed because the Spirit of glory and of God rest on you." Peter's still talking to Christians here. So he's talking to us. He says, fellow believers. He identifies with his audience. And then he says, when the fiery ordeal happens. Don't you wish he said if? Don't you wish he just said, well, if a fiery ordeal happens, that no, he says, when it happens. So is there's this preconceived and understood statement that there are going to be trials and there are going to be testings. But it's interesting, here he uses the word fiery ordeal. For the Christians in that day, they had a very vivid picture of fiery persecution. You see, in that time, Christians were being taken and impaled on a stake, dipped into tar, and set on fire to light the way, to be the torches, human torches in Nero's gardens. They understood fiery ordeals for the cause of Christ. You say, we don't have those kinds of things. And I would say, yet. Persecution is coming. But we must make up our mind whether we are going to be the people that will endure the testing before it gets here. So there was this picture, vivid picture in their mind of these fellow believers being burned at the stake. But they also had the understanding that fire was required and heat was required in the purifying of gold and silver. Now, we've talked about that several times. You take the gold, you take that precious metal, you put it in that container, you heat it up. And it's as it starts to heat and boil, the impurities rise to the top. It's what they call the dross. And then it would be that dross, those impurities would be raked off. And the jeweler, or the one that was working with that metal, would be looking at that. And when he could get it so pure that he could see his own reflection, then he knew he had gotten the impurities out. What a picture of what God is doing in our lives, what Christ is doing through the testings, turning up the heat on our lives, watching, raking that dross off. But look, he's looking for his reflection. So the question is, are the trials, are the testings that take place in our lives, are they bringing us to the point, or are we allowing him to remove the impurities so that when he sees us, he sees his reflection in our lives? I've heard people say, well, he's looking at my heart. No, he's also looking at your actions. Because if your actions don't, but your actions will follow your heart. So if your actions are demonstrating unrighteousness, he's not through with you yet. And the truth of the matter, he's not through with any of us yet, because none of us are perfect yet. And so there will always be those trials and those testings to remove the impurities from our lives, preparing us for that time as believers when we are going to be in heaven and be perfect in the presence of God. So Peter says there will be these tests, these various forms. It will be in various degrees of struggle that you will go through in your life as a Christian. He says you will also, and we've looked at in weeks before, there will be these persecutions that are a result of righteous living. Because you're living the Christian life, the world is going to persecute you in various forms and various levels. We could probably start on one side of this room and work to the other side of the room, and every one of us would have some story of why how I was persecuted as a Christian. Some of you maybe were overlooked for jobs or promotions. Some of you couldn't be in the in crowd. You just didn't fit because you had a different standard, and so there was persecution. Thankfully, in our country, we have not seen the persecution to the level of most places around this world. And when you think of persecution and you think of that as a testing, I've heard some say, "But yeah, but that's not God, that is evil people. Those are pagans, those are ungodly people that are just treating us bad." Listen, God can, God will, and God has, and He will again use pagans to purify His people. He uses, read the Old Testament and see how many times He took pagan, ungodly nations and brought them and had them come face to face with His people and literally defeated them at times, so to bring them back to Himself. As I look at our country today, the biggest problem I see is that the church has quit being the church, and I believe what we see going on today is God trying to bring His people back to Himself. And we're over here whining about it. Look how they're treating me. He said His purpose is to purify us. That's why the testing comes. Peter says, don't be surprised. Now, come on, he's not saying don't be surprised when it happens. I mean, have you noticed how those things come out of the clear blue? Everything's going fine, and all of a sudden, bam, you get hit upside the head with something, and it's, where did that come from? He's saying, I mean, he understands we're human, and those things are going to catch us off guard. But what he's saying here is don't live in a sense of bewilderment, of, I mean, walking around in a fog, I just can't believe this is happening, and stay that way. He said, it'll catch you off guard. Yeah, you'll be shocked for a second, but very quickly understand, don't be surprised by the fact that it has happened. Live that strong, godly life in the midst of it. Again, we've been sheltered in America. But if you want to bring it to a current event, let me tell you. This weekend, something happened that makes the slippery slope of humanism and liberalism and the lack of religious liberty closer than we ever believed. With Justice Scalia's death, folks, the slippery slope has just gotten slimier. Now, you don't have to agree with everything and all of his decisions, but let me tell you, he was one of the biggest champions on that Supreme Court for religious liberty. And if you don't think the ungodly ones and the liberals are not licking their chops right now to say, let's see who we can put in, because see, we've got a court that up until Friday or Saturday, whenever he passed away, was 5-4 in most decisions. Folks, this is one of the conservatives, one of the ones that stood strong for religious liberty. It could, if a liberal is put in there, it changes the whole dynamics of our Supreme Court. Religious liberty is at stake here. This is why people say, well, is it a big deal whether I vote or not? And this wasn't planned to be an election sermon, but let me tell you, it makes a huge difference whether Christians vote or not. Because as the leader goes, and my prayer is that our congressmen will and senators will block whatever comes out in, because Obama's already said he's going to appoint somebody in due time, which means between now and the end of his term, but they can block it. They can stall. And my prayer is that they will. They will stand up for what's right. Folks, religious liberty, what we know as our ability to worship the way we worship, what we know in standing for life, What we know and standing for biblical principles is at stake today in our country. How much we will suffer for the sake of the gospel, I believe, is at stake today. So, the things that Peter writes was written 2,000 or so years ago. Folks, it matters today. We need to understand we're going to endure some tests. He says, don't be surprised and don't live in surprise as it comes. Not only says, don't be surprised, he goes on in verses 13 and 14, instead rejoice. And I'm going, really? Rejoice, be happy because you're suffering? Well, look what he says. Rejoice as you share in the sufferings of the Messiah. Do you think you're any better than the Messiah? Than Jesus Christ? He suffered. So why do we think that we won't suffer? He says, do that so that you may rejoice with great joy at the revelation of his glory. If you are ridiculed for the name of Christ, you are blessed, because the Spirit of glory and of God rests on you. Oh, Peter, man, that was so easy for you to say. Peter, that was awful easy for you to write down if you just understood. Well, you remember Peter and John? In the book of Acts, they get thrown in jail. What were they guilty of? Preaching the gospel. They chastise them a little bit and they release them and say, don't do it again. They did it again. They put them back in jail. They've got them locked up, and this time they beat them and they release them. And as they release them, the Bible says they were told not to speak in the name of Jesus. So don't you know, they walked off quietly. They hid. They shut their doors. They turned the microphones off. They probably still did church, but they just didn't do it where anybody could hear. Now, if you look at Acts chapter 5, verse 41 and 42, it says, then after they'd been beaten, after they'd been released, after they'd been told, do not speak the name of Jesus, it says, then they went out from the presence of the Sanhedrin, rejoicing that they were counted worthy to be dishonored on behalf of the name. Every day in the temple complex and in various homes, they continued teaching and proclaiming the good news that Jesus is the Messiah. Peter knew what he was talking about. Peter had been in that place. Peter had had more persecution than you and I have ever thought about, and he still kept preaching the name of Jesus Christ. Folks, that is the stickler today. That is the struggle with the world today. You can talk religion all day, and they don't care. You can talk church, and they don't care. But you put the name of Jesus Christ out there and they care, because it is Jesus that confronts them with their sin. He is the only way. For these people to say there are many ways to heaven, well, if that's the case, why is it only one way upsets anybody? Think about it. Nobody gets upset about anything else but Jesus. That tells me he is the only way, because he's the only one that Satan and the world is worried about. Peter said, you're going to face persecution. You're going to go through some testing, but you hang in there and you do it with joy. Not with happiness, but with joy. Knowing that you're going to have the joy of rejoicing in the end, and you keep preaching the name of Jesus Christ. That's what he calls us to do. Endure the test. So the question for us today is, what do you not trust about God? What do you not trust about God? Endure the test. Secondly, Peter says you need to know right from wrong. Look at verses 14 through 15. He says, if you're ridiculed for the name of Christ, you are blessed, because the Spirit of glory and of God rests on you. None of you, however, should suffer as a murderer, a thief, an evildoer, or as a meddler. Peter gives us two opposite ways of living, two opposite reasons for suffering. Both that he lists here in verse 14 and verse 15 are reasons that we will suffer. In verse 14, he says you're going to suffer if you live for Christ. When you live for the glory of God, there will be suffering. That's what we've talked about. But he said there's some other kind of sufferings too. And he says, don't you live a life in such a way that you are suffering because you're a murderer, a thief, an evildoer. Sounds pretty easy, right? I mean, I wouldn't do any of those things. Or would you? You see, when I looked at that the first time, I thought, okay, I just don't have to kill someone. I don't have to steal something. We'll deal with those two in particular. Well, then I started doing a little research. And I realized that you and I don't define things quite the way Jesus does. In Matthew chapter 5, in the Sermon on the Mount, I realized Jesus was a little stricter than we are. Because Jesus said, you have heard that it was said to your ancestors, do not murder, and whoever murders will be subject to judgment. But I tell you, everyone who is angry with his brother will be subject to judgment. And whoever says to his brother, fool, will be subject to the Sanhedrin. But whoever says you, moron, will be subject to hell fire. Do you notice how narrow Jesus gets with this? In other words, I can murder with my tongue. And judgment's coming for that. So when we say, oh, I've never killed anybody, really? Let's think about your words. How you've destroyed somebody. We were talking with Jerry and I, with somebody yesterday, talking about an individual who had destroyed a child, a teenager, with their words. Literally destroyed them. Oh, the kid was still alive, but here and here they were dead. That's murder, according to what Jesus just said. Malachi 3, 8, and 9. Will a man rob God? Because see, I'm not a thief. But Jesus says, will a man rob God? Or God says, yet you are robbing me. You ask, how do we rob you? By not making the payments of the tenth and the contributions. You are suffering under a curse, yet the whole nation, are you still robbing me? So we say we're not thieves, but God says if we don't tithe, we're thieves. We're robbing him. You see how much more narrow he is than what we define things today? You can go ahead and do some more reading on the Sermon on the Mount. You'll figure out real quickly that it's a matter of the heart. It all starts in the heart. And I think that's why he can throw that last one in there that seems kind of out of place, because he's talking about murder and stealing and evil doing, and then he goes, oh, don't be a meddler either. That'll thin the crowd. You know what a meddler is? It's somebody sticks their nose into somebody else's business. Listen, I've just about figured out I got enough of struggles of my own without sticking my nose in somebody else's business. Now, it doesn't mean we disregard and we ignore sin, but it means there's some things you need to let other people just quit sticking your nose in their business. He said, he puts it in the same list. Listen, that's going to cause you some suffering in the end. So there's those big black things that we see that we say that he says are sin, and you don't need to be suffering because of that. But he's saying there's even some things that we would call these little whites, the little gray sins, that we don't need to be doing either because they'll cause you to suffer. He's saying don't suffer because of doing evil. Suffer for being righteous, which means we've got to make a choice. We have to determine between right and wrong. Now check out what he says again in verse 16. But if anyone suffers as a Christian, he should not be ashamed, but should glorify God with that name. Don't be embarrassed when you're ridiculed for taking a godly stand. Don't be embarrassed when you're living a righteous life and people make fun of you. Stand proud. Glorify God with the name. What name? You can put one of two there, Christ or Christian. Okay, because Christians, as Christians, we are little Christ, not saying that we're holy and we're like He, not putting us on the same level as Him, but we are to be like Him. See, that, again, goes right back to the refining process, turning up the heat so that He sees His reflection in us. So, don't be embarrassed because of the name. Glorify God with the name. You're a Christian? People point their fingers at you? Hey, let them see Christ in you. Bring glory to God by the way you live. Know the difference in right or wrong. Even when you suffer, bring glory to God. In other words, in the way you handle, in the way you endure the suffering, bring glory to the name of God. Because God's word says there's a difference in right and wrong. What do you not trust about God? Choose right over wrong. Then he tells us to live with the goal in focus. Look at verses 17 through 19. For the time has come for judgment to begin with God's household. And if it begins with us, what will be the outcome for those who disobey the gospel of God? And if the righteous is saved with difficulty, what will become of the ungodly and the sinner? For those who suffer according to God's will should, in doing good, entrust themselves to a faithful Creator. We saw it earlier. He tests us, refining us as we endure the test. Peter says he's also the judge. He will determine how you will be judged for what you do. Let me tell you, people might pull the wool over the judicial system. They might slip through in technicalities in this world. But when God stands as a judge, nobody gets off on a technicality. Nobody snookers the system. God is the righteous judge. And it says he will bring judgment to his household first. If you ever grasp the gravity of that, it might cause you to stop praying so much, God, take them out. God, take care of them. God, let your vengeance fall on them. Because he says, we're going to get it first. And when I look at that, that means that, I mean, how can he bring judgment to the world when his own people are acting like the world and not bring judgment on his own people? Folks, he will bring judgment on the house of God first. I really believe this set of verses here really summarizes the entire book of 1 Peter. It may be the most pertinent words for us to hear and understand today. For the time has come for judgment to begin with God's household. Do you think that might be what's happening today in America? God is in the process of bringing judgment on His people. One commentator describes it like this: the effect of persecution is to show up in the church those who really believe and are prepared to stand firm. That's one group. He goes on, and those who do not believe and so fall away under trial. The judgment also purifies the true believers, encouraging them to not commit shameful acts. We have so blended, and even in America, and I am not anti-American, folks, I love America. That's why it matters to me about the elections. But let me tell you, we have so blended patriotism and our faith. We have so blended the American life, and we think that American Christianity, we blended it to make it look like something that I don't think the Bible ever intended it to be. We have excused things. We've made up ways because we want bigger and bigger crowds. And what this tells me that when judgment comes, it will be a crowd-thinning event. Because we will find out then when persecution comes to the church, it won't be just about whether we get our tax advantage when we pay our tithes. It will be, and it is already in many places in this world, whether you live or die, whether you get food or not. But let me tell you, throughout biblical history, God's people stand firm. God's true people stand firm. And so we've got to say, we are ready, we're not looking forward to it, but I want to be the kind of believer, I want to be the kind of Christian that when persecution comes, I stand strong in the face of it for the cause of Christ and His kingdom. Because what I read here is what we go through here is just the beginning. There's other things to come. And we have to look with eternity in mind. Let me ask you this. If God's judgment on His people that He loves is severe, can you imagine what it is ultimately for those that don't love Him and that reject Him? You see, today we look at it and we say, oh, look, they're getting by with so much. It seems like they're the most ungodly people, yet they're being blessed somehow. Everything they touch turns to gold. Hey, God will take care of that. If it's going to be difficult for His people to go through judgment, it will be even more difficult for the non-believers to go through it, because theirs will be for all eternity. What do we do with our suffering? Verse 19 says, those who suffer according to God's will should, in doing good, entrust themselves to a faithful Creator. If I can trust Him for my salvation, why can't I trust Him for my everyday life? If I can trust Him to save me from eternal hell, then why can I not trust Him for the difficulties that I will go through in this life? Entrust yourself to Him. How do you do it? How do you focus on the future? Maybe the better question is, how do you suffer well? You ever thought about it? How do you suffer well? How do you suffer righteously? Well, I think Paul hits the nail on the head in Philippians. Philippians chapter 3, verses 7 through 9. Paul says, but everything that was a gain to me, I have considered to be a loss because of Christ. More than that, I also consider everything to be a loss in view of the surpassing value of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord. Because of Him, I have suffered the loss of all things and consider them filth, so that I may gain Christ and be found in Him, not having righteousness of my own from the law, but one that is through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God based on faith. Everything else, he says, doesn't matter. What Paul has done is helped us put all of this stuff in perspective. The only thing that matters is Jesus Christ. The only thing that matters is Him. It's more than what we have or what we don't have or how we'll be treated. He said, and let me tell you, Paul had a pedigree. He had a list of accomplishments that were amazing before he was a Christian and even after he was a Christian. And then he said, I count it all as loss when it comes to knowing Christ. That's all that matters. I want to switch versions of the scripture with you for just a second. I want to keep reading out of Philippians chapter 3, but I want you to hear this, and I've used it multiple times over the last 11 years, but listen to this out of the Amplified Version, Philippians 3, 10 and 11. Paul says, for my determined purpose is. Folks, that means we always talk about this heart stuff. Let me tell you, Paul's saying it's a mind thing too. He said, I am making a conscious decision. I am saying that it is a determined purpose. That reminds me of a dog that won't let go. He says, my determined purpose is that I may know Him, that I may progressively become more deeply and intimately acquainted with Him. Speaking of Christ, perceiving and recognizing and understanding the wonders of His person more strongly and more clearly. Do you understand that we'll never grasp all of that? It's going to always be a process. However much you think you know about Christ, however much you think you've got figured out about Him, there's more. And it just gets more glorious the more it goes. He says, and that I may in some way come to know the power outflowing from His resurrection, which it exerts over believers, that I may so share His sufferings as to be continually transformed in spirit into His likeness, even to His death, in the hope that if possible, I may attain to the spiritual and moral resurrection that lifts me out from among the dead, even while in the body. That's living for Christ. That's suffering for the sake of Christ. Saying, I'm willing to endure whatever it takes for the name of Christ and for the kingdom of God. Paul had his share of heartaches, struggles, persecution. But he said, I've already determined here and here that there's a purpose. And Christ is the purpose. And my focus is on eternal. And my focus is on the things of God and the kingdom of God. And I have determined that I will live and even suffer and even die for the cause of Christ. It's what Peter's telling us to do here, folks. To have a resolve. And he's saying, but it's not a resolve that you have to even worry about the end. Because we have a Savior that we can trust. So the question comes back to the beginning question, what do you not trust about God? See, for me, I'd made a commitment. What I had to do is get to that place where I said, I trust Him no matter what. Because, see, we have lived lives as Christians in America that have actually been easy. I mean, it's easy to be a Christian in America, but not in the rest of the world. It wasn't, as I read Scripture, in the early church. As a matter of fact, we've seen a life for most of our lives where if you look at our world, the church is in the center and everything else is in the margins. But when you look at the early church, the church was on the margin and the political and military structure of the nations were in the center. Could we be going back to a time when the church is in the margins? Could that be the difficulty and the struggle and the persecutions that we're going to face? Because being a Christian isn't the thing to do. because taking the stands for Christ means going against the grain of society. But that's what we're called to do. And we can do it, Peter says, even with joy, even in the suffering, with joy, because we know the Savior. We know He will care for us not only on this earth, but in eternity. And even if I die standing for the cause of Christ, I live for all eternity.